I'm glad you looked beyond the glasses, because I know you've been between microphones pressing noses and certain members of the band wearing a loud jacket. I know you can get hung up on these things, and I don't.
Oh, man. Don't get me started on that. Everybody, this is not a drill. Welcome to another episode of The Audio Files. My name is John. His name is Andy.
It sure is.
He was a dancer. At the Coca. No, wrong song. So we're here to listen to some Barry No. We're here to listen, Barry White. Yes, we're here to listen to a song which Andy has picked for me. Andy, what do you have for me and the good folks and the bad folks at home?
Yeah, all the folks. I have an artist. First, lately I've been doing this whole like going over songs that I've enjoyed that I've heard thus far in 2023. But you know what? We're gonna go all the way back to October of 2022. And we are going to listen to a song by an artist named Joe P. No familiarity.
Is that separate or is it one word? Joe P.
It's literally like I would be Andrew B. So it's J-O-E-P. And that's it. Joe P.
Okay. JP, currently in witness protection. Yeah,
very, very modestly, modestly named named for his act. I suppose he could probably stand to doctor that up a bit. But
the witness who cannot be named will refer to as Joe P.
exactly. but the track that I want you to listen to is one called Color TV.
Okie dokie.
Awesome. Yeah, go off and let me know what you think. Also, I should probably say this is another live studio performance from WFUV, that public radio station. So
another note of initials I've got to remember in the right
order. Right. Won't happen. It's WFVU. That's probably what you'll go back and say.
Really nice sound of the guitar. It's a lovely, lovely tone to it. I like the sort of intro, the chiming with the pounding the drums as well. That's quite cool. Let's see where it goes.
While I sleep through the week, but I'm upstairs in your downstairs dancing, I'll just wait here for you. I'll just keep camping in your bed, build a tent, hold some pillows and pretend we're upstairs in your room while they're downstairs dancing. Yeah, off the black and white scene. Color TV, in the film you want to see.
this is growing on me quite a bit. And his vocals, it doesn't sound the same, but it's like he's trying to sing in the style of Tom York, even with the, but it still sounds great. Yeah, this is really growing on me, actually.
That I'm upstairs and you're downstairs dancing. I'll just wait here for you. I'll just keep camping in your bed, build a town, hold some pillows and pretend we're upstairs in your room while they're downstairs dancing. Yeah, right. Sounds like so much fun. Yeah. I'm upstairs in your room. You're downstairs dancing, but I'll just wait here for you. I'll just keep camping in your bed, oh, and soon I'll just forget I'm alone.
Sorry, but did you just say you're downstairs dancing and I'm upstairs in your room waiting, camping in your bed? Little creepy, mate. Yeah, that really grew on me, and I like the way they put some sort of dynamics into the song as well. I couldn't get Tom York out of my head, and the more he sang, the more it's sort of like his styling. Yeah, there's no bad thing. I enjoyed that quite a lot, actually, more and more as it went along. This is a good one. Let's find out a bit more about GOP. Let's go back with Andy.
All right, you've returned. And what say you on Joe P and this track, Color TV?
Yeah, I liked it. I thought that WTF did a very good version of them.
Expertly done, John.
Yeah, there you go. This was interesting, and there's some stuff in there that sort of rang a chord with me, if you give the pun. It begins with this chiming guitar, strumming, and then pounding drums. I have to say, the guitar itself, the guitar sound is a lovely tone. Yeah, really, really, really nice, and it is throughout the whole song, and it's a major feature of it. What they did in the song quite a bit is they played with the tempo as well. They were slowing it down quite louder, so kicking in a load of dynamics into it, which kept interest. I really liked it. So around about the minute mark, they slowed it down. I put my notes not for the last time. And then it goes back into a faster tempo. And at this point, it started to grow on me. I have to say, for me, the obvious thing screaming out was that he doesn't have the same voice, but he was singing in the style, for me, of Tom York. A lot of Tom York in it. which is no bad thing, and it's his own voice. You know, he's not trying to do mimicry or anything, but the way he did it was very much. Now, I don't know if Huge Master knows, because I was actually really fascinated by this, but I'm guessing the chorusy part, somewhere along the lines of, but I'm upstairs in your room and you're downstairs dancing, I'll just wait here for you, I'll just keep camping in your bed. I know that's not all of it, but that's what I've got. Mm. I don't get the context, but it did sound a little creepy to me. A little bit creepy. And it continues on, and there's a bit in it where he sings black and white TV, and it just varies the strumming patterns and stuff in it. And that bit where he's strumming sounded awesome.
Yeah, it did.
Really, really good. And then there was another slightly slowed chorus, and he goes into stretched vocals. He sings something about running out of supplies. And there's a couple of falsetto notes as well, which I really enjoyed. Mm-hmm. And then there's what I'll call the bridge. So there's a really fast, brief strumming, you know, just bear with me when I think of the next bit. and loads of cymbal work as well, you know. And then it doesn't just slow down, it actually stops for a brief period. And then he's singing again. And then when it kicks back in proper, it sounds great.
Mm-hmm.
And there's more vocal stylings. And at this point, Tom York is fully in the room because he's even doing like the head wiggles as he sings, which just reminded me of, you know, so much of Tom York, Glastonbury, you know, when he's doing, go on.
Yeah, I didn't even think about Tom York. And then right when you said Tom York, I thought less about his sound or even like the style, and I instantly went to those head shakes, and I'm like, yep, I see Tom York. I saw Tom York before I even heard the similarities to Tom York. But you're right, the big fish ain't the little, like, and the know, and the head shaking and all that shit he does, it checks out. Absolutely astute observation, John.
Yeah, and it's when he's stretching the vocals and the longer notes that really reminds me. Again, his voice doesn't sound the same, but it's the way he delivers it. But, you know, really interesting. So at this point, the song has really grown on me. And I could imagine this done through a Radiohead filter, as it were, and being on the bends. I mean, I really could, which is, if you know me, high praise, because it's my favorite Radiohead album, actually.
Yeah.
So in terms of the lyrics, I only really got the creepy chorus and that line, running out of supplies. But because of that, I got the impression that, or it made me think of a kind of, I don't know why, a post-apocalyptic scenario where there's this person holed up waiting for someone who will never come, and it's just feeding off memories and fantasies. That's the kind of thing I got from it, which is totally wrong, I know, but that's what I got. It's mine.
No, it's,
I'm keeping it.
Hella interesting to get that bird's eye view into how your imagination works. Even like the whole first part of what you just said is complete horseshit as far as it being the actual case. Cool and interesting way that you thought of it, but perhaps there's something to the second bit of what you said, the overall feeling of, like, you know, being stuck without someone you're longing for, clinging to hope.
It's the running out of supplies made me think of that. And I'm sure it's just a guy who's fucking run out of munchies because he's all fucking weeded up. You know, it's not as serious as a post-nuclear strike situation, but that's where my mind goes because, you know. But yeah, really, really nice live performance from a three-piece band. I have mentioned the bass player, and I'm sorry, he did a great part. He didn't stand out to me as much as the main guy did with his guitar and even the drums, but it's solid, you know, and the whole thing as a sound was great. Mm-hmm. And just as a side note, I can't explain why, it is a total instinct thing, but I deeply dislike yellow tinted glasses. Okay.
Yeah.
It's just a thing, but it didn't spoil it for me. So that's the main thing to take from that.
Thank God.
So yeah, really like this. This is a very good pick.
I'm glad. I'm really glad you liked it. And, you know, I'm glad you looked beyond the glasses, because I know you've been between microphones pressing noses and certain members of the band wearing a loud jacket. I know you can get hung up on these things. And I
don't. Don't get me started on that fucking sax player again. How dare he? How dare he?
Oh, use your sports code. What the fuck? This is like, it's one of those things where you probably had this too in your music listening, you know, tenure or experience. But when you have those songs that are your favorite songs now, and you don't know if in 10 years you'll look back and say, oh yeah, that's one of my all-time favorite songs. But in the here and now of your life, there is a song that's like your favorite. This is for me. This is that. Like, since I heard this in late 2022 to now, I listened to it several times a week. And there's the aspect of it. Like, you know, you listen to some things and maybe it's not overtly what it's about, but some essence of it rings true to you for a situation that you're in. Like I feel this song resonates with me, and being in a long distance relationship with someone who I'm like emphatically in love with, and us having to navigate that for the time being until we set up shop here, and all that. And in those moments of like longing or like feeling of loneliness, this song so beautifully rings true to me. And I often listen to it, and maybe it's the music is so like all indie rock, but the sentiments of the lyrics to me are so emo, and perhaps it tugs a bit at that in me that still resides in this heart that hasn't completely calloused over yet. But I absolutely love this song so much, and I'm glad that you received it as warmly as you did, and you found a lot of the redeeming things in it that I did and still do, obviously, to this day. So I also think something that's fun visually about it is, here's this kind of knackered looking lanky guy with his hair everywhere, and his beard is between non-existing and existing. And he's playing this SG that's all ragged and like worn in the middle. And there's just like this parallel between the weatheredness of his guitar and kind of his own aesthetic. And I just find that interesting as well, from a visual standpoint. But yeah, Joe P was part of a band called Deal Casino from like 2013 to 2020, and they had gotten a lot of steam in the mid-Atlantic and the northeast of the United States, and were starting to kind of get a lot on a lot of people's radars. They formed in 2013, and by the end of 2014, they dominated a very like regionally prestigious like up and coming music award ceremony called the Asbury Park, and that's a part of New Jersey where these guys are from, Asbury Park Music Awards. And they drew comparisons to early Smashing Pumpkins, and which I know you're a fan of, the early Pumpkins, and they won more awards than any other group in the history of the award ceremony, including Best Pop and Rock Band, Best Vocalist, and Best Live Performance. And they were, just as they were picking up a lot of steam and getting some really, really good press, Joe announced that Jazzel Cow and John Rodney would be leaving the band, and on, I guess, amicable terms, but that they would just be going separate ways and Joe was going to start doing his own thing. And that was in 2020. So at this point, Joe Perella is what the P stands for. Has released two EPs, and one was in 2021, and the other, like I said earlier, was in October of 2022. The one that came out in 2021 is called Emily Can't Sing, and one of a really beautiful song off that called Off My Mind that I might bring, knowing that you like what you heard here, might bring to the table, has like 11 million streams on Spotify, which is really, really good for a guy that never got big, never broke out or whatever. And from a band who also kind of never got big or never broke out. But I hope that he continues to write music and continues to push through, because I just think he's a phenomenal musician and songwriter. So I will go over the song with you lyrically. So pick out your face. Which one today? What will they say? I say what I mean to the back of my teeth while I sleep through the week. But I'm upstairs in your room and you're downstairs dancing. I'll just wait here for you. I'll just keep camping in your bed, build a tent, hold some pillows and pretend we're upstairs in your room while they're downstairs dancing, yeah? I'm the black and white scenes on a color TV in a film you won't see. You get what you get and you don't get upset, so I try to forget. But I'm upstairs in your room and you're downstairs dancing. I'll just wait here for you. I'll just keep camping in your bed, build a tent, hold some pillows and pretend we're upstairs in your room while they're downstairs dancing, yeah? Running out of supplies, right? The apocalypse. So this is the bridge.
I don't hear anything that disproves my theory so far.
Running out of supplies, trying my best to survive.
Sick.
And all my friends are slowly dying one by one.
There you go.
But it sounds like so much fun. I'm upstairs in your room. You're downstairs dancing, but I'll just wait here for you. I'll just keep camping in your bed. Oh, and soon I'll just forget I'm all alone in your room. Oh, and he can like takes it out doing all those flourishes vocally. I kind of look at it like the room is her room is a metaphor for a place that it, like her own bedroom would be intimately connected with her and kind of like her shell, like her area. And he's stuck in that. And so
it's the space in his head, which is her.
Yes. Yes. And that's her room. And so he's connecting the literal bedroom aspect of it to this, like, you know, one that he's created, this metaphor where he's stuck in the thought of her, which is her room. Right. And just I'm upstairs in your room and you're downstairs dancing, like you're away from here. And in my mind or estimation, probably out there having fun or, you know, enjoying life. And I'm, you know, I'll just keep camping in your bed, build a tent, hold some pillows and pretend that we're upstairs in your room while everyone else is downstairs dancing, doing their own thing. And it's just fucking poetic and like equally beautiful and tragic at the same time to me when I break down and look at those lyrics. I just really, really adore it. It's simple. The melodies, even like he'll hit a note and the way he resonates almost creates this buzzing hum in certain parts of the song when he's delivering it, especially in that live, and you get to see it. And it's just, I don't know, man, it hits different with me. I've got a little synopsis here.
It's just really interesting because unless I missed something when you're reading the lyrics out, it's very much from his point of view.
Oh yeah. Yeah.
Yeah. So there's nothing coming back about what she thinks or feels. And so you immediately go to a romantic scenario where he's longing and missing her. I immediately go to is a creepy stalker scenario. I mean, it's just the way our two minds work. And they're not, sometimes we would go the other way, but for this song, my instinct straight away was this guy's a creep.
Yeah.
And, you know, and you're like, oh, you know, this is so heartfelt and romantic and everything. And it's just interesting.
Yeah.
And a different song, our minds are working a different way. You know, it's just funny.
Yeah.
And I totally see what you're saying, you know, and I don't disagree with it at all.
Yeah. There's sort of this like unrequited aspect of it, or like this hurdle in a relationship or something like that aspect to it that I get from it. But yeah, and you had said even like it's very much from his POV, like even when he starts off the song with pick out your face, which one today, what will they say? It's about him. He's not talking about you. It's like, so he's like telling himself, so pick out your face, which one today, like what phony visage am I going to portray while I hide these feelings, like while I say these things that I only say to the back of my teeth because I can't open my mouth to say them. Is really, really cool and interesting. I just love that.
Oh, he's putting on his suit and everything to go outside in the radioactive dust. That's
what exactly. Yeah, he's putting on his gas mask, of course. Yeah. So I found this interesting write up, which I mostly agree with, and I thought I'd share is. Color TV by Joe P appears to be a song about unrequited love. The protagonist seems to have feelings for someone who is not reciprocating those feelings or who is perceived to not reciprocate those feelings. He asks himself which face to put on when he is around this person, indicating that he is trying to impress them. he feels like he is separate from everyone else, as if he's watching the world through an old black and white television set compared to the vibrant and vivid color TV. The chorus of the song emphasizes the distance between the protagonist and the person he desires. While she is downstairs dancing, he is left upstairs waiting for her. He feels like an outsider, camping out in her bed, wishing for a chance to be with her. The bridge of the song suggests the protagonist's life is falling apart, with his friends dying one by one. However, he is still more focused on his unrequited love for the girl. Overall, Color TV speaks to the feeling of longing for someone who is out of reach, and the desire to be with a person even when the situation seems impossible. So, yeah, that's, I tend to agree with that synopsis, though. Who doesn't love a good post-apocalyptic story? But yeah, man, I am so glad you dug this. It's really cool, because in sharing this song that I'm far more familiar with at this juncture than you are, you still were able to, by being a new set of ears and eyes, bring to my attention sort of similarities to a band that I love in Radiohead, or a musician in Thom Yorke that I love, because there are similarities to their approach, not necessarily the finished product, that was there, and I never really saw that. And I totally agree. The guitar work is fucking awesome. A proof yet again that you don't have to be, you know, Eddie Van Halen or Dimebag Darrell or any of these speed thrash guys to be an excellent guitarist and write an excellent tune with the guitar as the featured player. So yeah, beautiful tune. Really glad you liked it. This particular tune, I didn't mention the name, is off his second EP, which is called French Blonde. And that came out in October 22, if anyone's interested in going and checking it out. I'll probably be bringing more of him, his work, and possibly even a Deal Casino track to the channel in the future. All that being said, John, thank you so much for your honest assessment. I'm glad that we are comrades in liking this song. Everybody out there in the listening audience, let us know what you thought of this track, what you think of Joe P, this sort of live performance, studio performance from WFUV. You both know that we like, or y'all know that we both like it. Tell us what you think. That's what the comment section is there for. If you enjoyed this video, if you enjoy your time here, if you enjoy the product that we're putting out, please, 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 if you're new here, like, share, and subscribe. To those that already have, we thank you. We adore you. We appreciate you. All that being said, we will see you on the next episode of The Audiophiles. See you later, guys.